Reminder of, you wonder if this is something that people anticipate. We now live in the age of cell phone. We now rely on cell phones for so much. When there's chaos like this, too many people on the cell phones, they don't work.
Well, one of the things that they had to deal with today, Attorney General Ashcroft was en route to Milwaukee today. And now with the planes grounded, he's going to have to communicate by phone. They have an internal communication system at the Justice Department that they use in situations like this, video monitors. But again, everyone is dispersed, and with the planes grounded, this created a scenario that they had, quite frankly, hadn't seen before.
It is the grounding of the planes which pretty much brings to a halt. I mean, one assumes that Air Force One, with the president, is already on its way back to Florida. Okay. All right. Thank you very much. ABC's John McQuethy is on a cell phone at the moment, and while he cannot hear me, somebody can tell him to start talking, please, and we'll listen. Okay, we'll try that again. Anytime John McQuethy begins to talk and tell us what's happening at the Pentagon, or as much as he knows what's happening at the Pentagon, we will simply let him go. But it's just very difficult to get through on cell phones. Thousands of people trying to find out where their friends and their relatives are. Thousands of reporters, news organizations, city organizations, state organizations, federal organizations, trying to understand not only what happened today, which in some respects is secondary, but to get something done. And there's just so much agitation around. You get a report just a couple of moments ago from the security at the Capitol Police saying that they believe a hijacked plane may be bound for the Capitol. There's an intensity in the air and a fear and a trauma in the air at 20 minutes to 11 Eastern time in the United States, 20 minutes to 8 on the West Coast, or in the western part of the United States. The day has just getting beginning, and all of this has happened in under an hour. The first attack on the Trade Tower was just before 10 o'clock. The second one came at 3 minutes after 10. We have a strike on the Pentagon, which came a little after that. And the country is just riddled. 9 o'clock. The country is just overrun, as it's inevitable it would be, with rumors. I'm curious, John, in terms of the emergency operation that you monitor, are they in a sense of panic? Are they in a sense of chaos?
In a sense of chaos, there was a brief sense of panic, which is understandable, when the first tower collapsed. By the time the second tower collapsed, they were prepared for it. There were numerous other injuries. The level of coordination is incredible. The FDR Drive, which is a main artery, has been shut down for the purpose of keeping it clear for ambulances to go to hospitals. They've anticipated that the lower Manhattan hospitals in New York City will fill up, so they have started to arrange helicopter flights to go to hospitals further out in the circle. They've really been pretty well coordinated throughout this, if you can possibly be coordinated during a series of spontaneous events that amount to disaster.
This is war, and war by another definition.
We did manage to get
Rebecca Cooper, one of our reporters, on the phone from the White House. That's how difficult it is at the moment to communicate. Rebecca, do you hear me? Rebecca Cooper at the White House, do you hear me? All right, the same case with Rebecca's as with John McQuethy at the Pentagon. If we do hear from them, we'll simply interrupt and let them get
Hello?
On talking. Yeah, Rebecca, do you hear me?
Yes, Peter, I hear you. I'm in the basement of 815 Connecticut Avenue. It's a building across the block from the White House, across the park. You know where that is, next to the Chamber of Commerce. I had to come down here because, as you said, none of the cell phones are working. I'm in the engineer's office, and they've given us their phones to use. There's a real dichotomy here at the White House, Peter. Tourists who still are not fully aware of what's happening across the nation are standing there watching with curiosity. They keep getting moved back. But those of us who are inside the White House realize the severity of the situation. I was inside the White House this morning trying to gather information for you when we were told by a very nervous White House security staff that they feared a plane was headed to the White House, and we heard planes indeed overhead, and they quickly evacuated all of us out of the White House. Now, I just got off the phone with my own crying mother, who was very worried about where I was, and I will tell other mothers and fathers of people who work at the White House and reporters who work at the White House that most of the White House has been evacuated. In fact, in the building where I am now, People have cordoned off other offices to try and coordinate the federal response to this. There are actually phone calls being placed to the legal counsel of the FAA from this building because they don't have cell phone connections. They are out of their offices. They are doing a good job of coordinating the federal response from here, but they are having to take all kinds of emergency measures to coordinate this response. But even the White House chef, who just days ago was preparing a lovely state dinner for President Fox of Mexico, I saw him and I tried to speak to him. And frankly, Peter, he was too rattled. He said he couldn't speak, and he was with his staff, and they were all very anxious and very worried because, of course, they did know what's going on in the country today.
Many thanks, Rebecca Cooper. And if you just see that picture that was going by as Rebecca was talking, you get a real sense of what the urgency was in the White House. First of all, the White House police came walking out, and then people began to run out of the White House. In and of itself, astonishing, because we live with the notion that if there is any place in the United States which is fiercely protected, including an anti-aircraft battery, at least one on the roof of the White House itself, this is the place where the president and the vice president, of course, are to be secure. Claire Shipman is on the phone from the White House. Claire, we are now looking at what appear to be fairly relaxed security officers on the roof of the White House, looking at in the distance as they always do, talking occasionally to each other. There doesn't seem to be a high level of tension there. What's it like on the ground?
Well, there is considerable tension on the ground, Peter. We are actually looking at a similar picture because we're across the street from the White House now in the Hay Adams Hotel. The entire area around the White House has been completely evacuated. It's very quiet. The police seem tense. They're carrying automatic weapons. We've also seen a couple of what appear to be fighter jets overhead. Everybody in this area has been sent home from all major government offices. It's a reverse commute. The highways, we're told, are just jammed. As you know, President Bush is on his way back to the White House. They've checked his plane considerably before sending him on his way. But as you mentioned, these guys on top of the White House roof are almost always here. And ever since that incident a few years ago, when a plane actually landed on the White House lawn, they've upped security measures so that they wouldn't have any other aircraft nearby. And that may be why they seem a little more relaxed than other areas around town. As you know, the AP has been reporting that there was a car bomb that went off at the State Department, and a lot of people are talking about that. And there's also been some report that there were bomb threats on Capitol Hill, but we're still trying to find out more about that, Peter.
Thanks very much, Claire. There are indeed reports from the Federal Aviation Administration that there are possibly one or two more planes that have been hijacked this morning and are still missing. When you think of the number of aircraft that crisscross the United States, not to mention fly overseas every day, this is the Pentagon. This is the Pentagon. This is live coverage from the Pentagon now, which gives you some sense of the force with which this aircraft, described to us as a small commuter-sized aircraft, flew into a side of the Pentagon coming from the south this morning. And again, the communications in the country are so difficult at the moment, and as you've heard from everybody, the cell phone network is choked for a variety of reasons, that it's hard to get a handle at this point on casualties at the Pentagon or the extent of damage. The one place in which we can be focused, because it is such a small place, Manhattan, 11 miles long, is the Twin Trade Towers. And by some remote chance, if you've just joined us on television, the Twin Trade Towers in New York City have been destroyed, with hundreds, presumably, or perhaps thousands of people in them. Each of the two towers was struck today, attacked today, by an aircraft, one of which at least we know was hijacked. And this is the second tower that went just a few minutes ago. A scene of chaos and devastation in the lower part of New York City, right on the edge of the Hudson River. Everybody in the United States is familiar with the Twin Trade Towers, and we have no idea whether there were tourists there who show up every morning to go and stand on the top of the Trade Towers, because it is one of the most expansive views, southwest and north of the city and the area itself. Bill Blakemore is down there. Bill, do you hear me?
I do, Peter.
Go ahead.
I'm just north of Canal Street, just a few blocks north of the Trade Tower area. Throngs of people have been, of course, moving north. Some of them silent, most of them looking stunned, just saying, we're just trying to get out of the area after both towers have collapsed. We're seeing Delta Wing jet fighters circling overhead, just one at a time. When the first one appeared, the group of people amid which I was standing shrieked and said, oh my God, there's another attack. And then they realized that being a Delta Wing jet fighter, it was probably the U.S. military, which of course it seems to be. There's just a couple of helicopters, apparently police helicopters, circling overhead. And on this very clear morning now, the unusual sight is the lack of the Trade Tower sticking up above the buildings that are normally here. People have now begun to accept, but just barely begun to accept what's happened. All business at a complete standstill, nothing but sirens down here as these throngs move further and further north, just walking away from what they can barely begin to understand. Peter?
Bill, how far north did this, I mean, we looked at some streets which debris had just gone in a huge wide area.
Right. I seem to be just north of where that hit. I'm just up at Canal, so there seem to have been enough low-lying buildings, that is, no more than, say, 20 or 30 stories high, between us and the base of the tower to have protected people here from the debris. But here's another man walking past me, just looking completely dazed, going north. Two or three other women, the crowds are beginning to thin out now, as most of the people who were just standing around and watching were working there. One woman came up, just talking a mile a minute with her daughter and her friend and her daughter, describing how they had gone to their school this morning. She was about to go to the Trade Tower to pick up something from a shop there when her daughter said, I want a sandwich, Mommy, and so she stayed back. She said, otherwise I would have been there. They're still trying to understand how they're so lucky not to have been over there. There must be thousands of such stories here this morning, Peter, of those that were the lucky ones.
Thank you, Bill. Please stay in touch as often as you can. It's now 10 minutes to 11 Eastern time, 10 minutes to east in 2 minutes to 8 in the west. And I'm just going to add to the chaos and the trauma of the day by saying that a large plane has now crashed just north, or shouldn't I say just, but crashed about 10 o'clock in the last 15 minutes north of Somerset County Airport, about 80 miles southeast of Pittsburgh. This is reporting from one of the Pittsburgh television stations as a result of a 911 call from the airport itself. There are no other details on this crash yet, and it's not clear whether the crash was related to anything else that has happened in the country today. But the plane, which was believed to be a Boeing 767, crashed about 10 a.m., just about 8 miles east of Jennerston, Pennsylvania. People in the area will undoubtedly be reporting in more clearly to us on that. The New York mayor's race is having a primary today. That has now been canceled. Both on the Republican and the Democratic side, there was I apologize for interruption. Somebody's trying to say something. Go ahead, please. Okay, just stand by just for 1 second while I just finish. Just repeating, the New York mayoralty primary has been canceled today. And as we said, there's reaction coming in from the Middle East, including a claim of responsibility, then a denied responsibility, now a message from the Palestinian president, Yasser Arafat, condemning the aircraft attacks on the World Trade Center and sending the condolences of the Palestinian people to those who have been victimized by it. Outside the Pentagon, another member of our ABC News staff, Chris Dreer. Chris, can you hear me?
Yes, I can, Peter.
So would you tell us what you can see?
Yes, Peter. I'm standing at the fringe of Arlington Cemetery watching the Pentagon as the top of it caves in. There's a lot of black smoke, a lot of twisted debris. The Pentagon itself has caved in from the top. There is much fire coming out of the windows. It looks like something from World War II, Peter.
Chris, can you tell me, it's a little hard to tell on television, how